This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. We're here to lift you and not put you down.
Be with you. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to be in your living room, car, or wherever you are watching or hearing this. It's always my thrill to be with you. Today's message is coming from a deep place in my heart. I want to talk about lost in a crowd. I see this sense of lost and a sense of loss so much in what I sense as someone who prophetically tries to keep a sense of discernment of what's going on around us, both in the church and in our culture. And I want to address that today. My text comes from a story actually about Christ being lost. Imagine that. Luke 2, 43, 46 summarizes a story that when they, Mary and Joseph, had finished the days, this was the feast that they had taken Jesus to, as they returned, the boy Jesus lingered behind in Jerusalem. And Joseph and his mother did not know it, but supposing him to have been in the company, they went a day's journey. And they sought them among their relatives and acquaintances. So they did not find him, and so they returned to Jerusalem seeking him. And now it was that after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. Wow, what a story. Imagine losing Jesus. As tragic and almost incomprehensible that is, it also paints a great analogy for our talk tonight, that you can lose your way. You can become lost. Now, let me just say, this is not a message concerning your salvation. I believe that the gift of salvation is just that. It's a gift. You didn't earn it, and it's not a reward. It is, in fact, a gift. So, as I'm talking about this today, I'm certainly not talking about your salvation. I believe it's secure. But I believe that we can lose our way. I believe that we can be, as we say often, lost in a crowd. The significance and pain of being lost is tragic in itself. The feeling of not knowing where you are, feeling disconnected. You may remember being lost as a child. The panic. Where's my mom? Where's my parents? Where are they? And that moment of recognizing you're lost is indescribable. It's beyond emotional expression. It's, I'm lost. Or you may be the parent who has lost your child at a mall or at a theme park, and that panic of being lost. There's a word that describes being lost. It's called bewildered. It's an interesting word. It was made up as a result of when they used to try to punish people. They would take them out in the wilderness, blindfold them and take them to the wilderness, and then spin them around until they lost their sense of balance and perspective, and then leave them alone, and thus the word bewildered. Have you ever felt lost? Have you ever felt bewildered? Have you ever felt like you don't know where you're at, where you're going? It's a terrifying feeling. In the world of survival, a phenomenal book was written about survival and who survives and who doesn't when it comes to plane accidents and people that are hiking, the weather turns, and people get lost. It's a phenomenal study. And it's really a study on how one becomes lost and what to do when you are lost. But I love the definition of lost in that context. Lost in that context, when there would be an airplane crash or a tragedy or the weather would turn on a hike, this is the definition of lost in that context. When one's mental map no longer matches the environment. In other words, we all have a map. We use a map. Thank goodness for the maps that we now have in our car. I'm severely ADD, which I actually don't mind. It gives me the ability to think about more things than one, and I have to do two or three things at one time or I get bored. I can't finish none of them, but that's not the point. But sometimes I have to literally use the map, my GPS, to get me home because I'm easily distracted and I'll find myself missing my exit. So I have it not only showing me, but talking to me. So maps are important, and maps map the soil or the land or the territory of which we are navigating our way through. But of course, when tragedy happens, when different things happen, and it no longer matches, now you're lost. The map is of no good. We have mental maps, right? This may be a crude illustration, but if you're sleeping and in the middle of the night, nature calls and you have to go to the restroom, you learn how to get from your bed to the restroom without any lights because you have a mental map, right? So you get up out of bed, you know to go about 3 feet over here, you turn right, there's a wall, then you go this way, there's a hallway, and then there's the door, and you pretty well make your way through all because you have a mental map that you have formulated in your mind. This is what to expect. This is where I'm at. And my map in my mind matches the environment where I am. Now, just imagine that while you're sleeping, somebody changes everything, spins you around, as it were, changes the furniture, changes the layout of the house, and now you get up, and now you're trying to use your mental map to navigate your way to the restroom, and you're stubbing your toe, you're running into walls, you're causing a disaster, and after about 2 or 3 minutes, you are lost. That moment of being lost is the sensation of which we must avoid. And yet, it constantly happens. We lose our way. If you want one more illustration about what it feels like to be lost, go to a Walmart or a Target or a shopping grocery store and watch people my age. I'm 66 years old. Watch people my age come out of the store and then have this bewildered look, where did I park my car? And we look like five-year-olds, like, well, that's what it means to be lost. And here in our text, we understand that Mary and Joseph went to the temple and for the feast for the cause of Christ. It was for his dedication. It was for his moment. And it was all about Jesus. And yet, in all of the excitement and all the activity, they lost Jesus. So you see, becoming lost is either something that we drift into because we get crowded out with activity and things, or sometimes tragedies happen and throw us into that state of being lost. We talked about changing the furniture and the structure of the house. Sometimes a death of a loved one. Sometimes a divorce, a loss of a job, moving, changing. There are things that happen in our lives that they choose us. And when that happens, all of a sudden, what was the routine, what was the rigor, what was the mundane, but the expected is just turned on its head. We are, as it were, taken into a wilderness and everything changes and we are bewildered. We are lost. I have no doubt in my mind that God has sent me to talk to you today, because I'm talking to you about this sense that your purpose and your relationships and the life that you once had so organized and so structured and had your goals and had everything set on what your life was going to be like in 5 years. First of all, could anybody could have imagined 5 years ago what we were about to face in the last 1,000 days? So in many ways, a lot of us are facing a map that doesn't match our environment. And so today, I believe this message is a message of healing, a message of hope, a message that will, before our time is done, and I pray that the true north of who you are and where you're going, the morning star that seemingly has been hidden in the dark, will rise in your heart and you will see clearly your way. But how does one become lost? And of all things, lost in a crowd. To think that we're in a culture where we have access through technology and through so many activities that no one should feel isolated. No one should feel alone. And yet we've never been more alone as a culture, never been more isolated. It's as if we are, in fact, lost in a crowd. And if I may say so, for Jesus to be lost in the temple, to be lost in church, what a tragedy. You would think of all the places that you would never lose your way would be the church. And yet, I made reference in a sermon several weeks ago about 39% of regular church attenders in the Christian community have not come back to in-person church. And I think it can be said that many lost their way. And in the midst of the crowd and in the midst of so much and on demand, watching any preacher, any worship service, so much crowd of opportunities. And yet in all of that, some of us feel lost. How does that happen? Well, I think we feel lost when expectations aren't met. I'll call it what it is, hype. You know, honestly, I've said I'm 66 years old, and I've also been raised in church all of my life. It's all I've ever known. I have probably averaged going to church 4 or 5 times a week for 66 years. And a lot of times, if we're not careful, we can create an environment that is not really real. It has a lot of hype. There's a lot of things said that don't match our map. And so what we hear on Sundays are, we hear, as it were, the Instagram, or what we used to say in my generation, the Reader's Digest version of our testimonies. We feel, wow, I don't have that testimony, or my life's not like that. And in an age of technology, and I sometimes, I laugh, yet in disgust, I watch television commercials, and I see people advertising cars and food, and you'll see them advertising a car, and it's going through mud puddles, and it's going up hills, and it's speeding through, you know, a desert, and you're looking at this vehicle, and you say, oh, man, I need to get this. And then if you'll pay attention, there's like this thin, these small letters on the bottom of the screen, and if you stop your screen and read it, it usually says something like, this was done on a professional driver, and it was on a course that was designed, and don't, you know, think that the car can actually do this. And you realize this is hype. And sadly, sometimes in an attempt to give people hope, we give people hype, and people start thinking, my mental map, my real life doesn't match what I'm hearing at church. And you have to be careful. Romans 16, 17, and 18 says, now, I urge you, brothers and sisters, note those that cause division and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you have learned, and avoid them. For such are those who serve not the Lord Jesus, but their own belly, and by smooth words and flattering speech deceive the hearts of the simple. And so I want to confess to you that sometimes you're not hearing the full story. Read the fine print. Sometimes the miracles you hear about didn't happen overnight. They happened through the night. And in an effort to get to the point, we look at our life and we feel like Christianity is hype. It's just smooth, flattering words someone's using to try to keep me engaged. And at some point, you hit a wall, and at some point, you say, this is not cut out for me. And you lose your way. Sometimes it's suddenly. It's as if you pray a prayer and it didn't get answered. A tragedy happened in your life. Something happened, and when you prayed, it in the moment, it's as if God didn't respond. And in that moment where you just feel so disappointed, and friend, I want to tell you that true hope doesn't disappoint. True hope is an anchor for your soul. But sometimes our own selfish desires and our own, the Bible says we're led away by our own lust, by our own desires for things to happen in a way that maybe are not God's ways. As a result, hype has replaced hope. And then we are disappointed. Our expectation in God and each other becomes deflated, and you feel lost. Who am I talking to right now that really, that you're watching is a miracle? Because in fact, you do feel lost. Perhaps even lost in a crowd of people and activities and opportunities. Today, God has sent me to help you get found. There's another reason that people get lost in their faith. And again, I'm not referring to your salvation. I'm talking about your ability to grow and to live a healthy Christian life is hypocrisy. Oh, how many of you have heard, oh, I don't go to church, or I don't want to, you know, continue my Christian walk because of all the hypocrites. And we were warned, Matthew 23, 13 says, woe to you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, he called them, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. For you neither go in yourself, nor do you allow those who are wanting to enter in to go in. I would tell you that hypocrisy is the both the explanation and the excuse for why a lot of people have lost their way. You look at people and they say one thing and do another thing. There seems to be a lack of integrity. Or worse, sometimes there really is a Pharisee spirit, kind of a holier-than-thou attitude. And you see these people just bursting and yelling and raising their voice, as it were, both literally and figuratively. And then you look at their life and you see, these people are hypocrites. And then if you're not careful, in a cynical, skeptical culture that we live in, where everybody seems to be so mean and so opinionated and, yes, so judgmental, if you're not careful, everyone seems to be a hypocrite. And here's the tragedy. At the very end, you then come to yourself and you say, well, out of all of the hypocrites that I know, I'm the worst. It's a term now people are using called the imposter syndrome. It's the sense that we sometimes think, I'm an imposter. people think I'm nice. People think I'm this. People think I'm that. But I know me. And if people really knew the real me, they wouldn't love me. They wouldn't want to be my friends. I'm an imposter. And basically that comes as a result of what the scripture tells us, is what you judge, you become. So when you become hard on other people, you'll ultimately be hard on yourself. When you judge other people's motives and intent, you will end up judging and second-guessing your own self. Paul made reference to Timothy as a young pastor. Be patient and be gentle with people who oppose themselves. How many of you have allowed the hypocrisy of other people to cause you to drift from where God wants you to be? It landed ultimately on you yourself feeling like a hypocrite. And now you are disconnected. You are lost. Get found. Today, I'm going to throw the anchor of hope. Today, I'm going to turn on the light. Today, I'm going to call out to you. Get found today. Don't remain lost. The last reason I'll deal with today that people get lost is that they get hurt. There's actually a term called church hurt. The Bible says in Luke 17:1, Jesus said, it's impossible that no offenses should come, but woe to him through whom they come. And so Jesus is telling us offenses are going to happen. And there's only one thing worse than being offended, and that's being the one that offends. That's a real hurt. But ultimately, in your walk with God, in your walk with your spouse, and your walk with your parents and with your friends, and certainly your walk in God with your church community, there will be offenses. There will be hurt. And there are so many Christians that are outside of the community of church relationships, church accountability, because they have let their hurt lead them to a place, you, that right now, you say, how did I get here? Or maybe you're still in the game. You're still, your map still matches your environment. But you're hurt. And this preacher's telling you today, you got to work through that hurt. Because that hurt will ultimately take you somewhere that no longer matches your belief system. And you will feel the great disconnect that so many are feeling. When you get hurt, it's important that you humble yourself, that you recognize that. Somebody said to me one time, when does the hurt stop hurting? Listen carefully, when the hurt stops hurting. In other words, it's a sense of pride. I know this is strong, but it is a sense of selfishness that when we get hurt, we take on that hurt as our identity. We take it and we own it and we embrace it. And all of a sudden, we've gone from who we are to we are that hurt. And we get our identity from that. We live in a culture where people are glorifying being victimized. So when somebody does something wrong to you or things are unfair, never give in to the temptation to become a victim, because in that moment, you have just become a slave. You have lost your power and given it to somebody else, maybe a system, maybe to other people, but never embrace. This is why our pastor always teaches us, I am never a victim, but always a victor. What is he saying to us? You may have been hurt, but do not embrace that hurt as your identity. And when you can separate the hurt from who you are, then the hurt will stop hurting. You have to say, I am not my hurt. I am a child of God who's capable of being hurt and hurting people hurt people. And in that humility, you have to say, God, I don't want to live with offense. And Lord, this is why every day I pray this prayer, the Lord's Prayer. And that one part of it says, forgive me as I forgive others. And what does that do? That reminds me that I'm forgiven and I can forgive others. And that every day I clear my emotional debt and say, I'm going to live debt-free today. I am not going to carry. The Bible says, owe no man nothing but to love one another. So you know what? You may have hurt me. You may not even be aware that you hurt me. And maybe it's not worth going through it because I'm going to love you. I'm going to stay in this relationship and we're going to keep this thing going because no doubt I have hurt. And so today, pray this prayer. Lord, I forgive those that have hurt me as I ask you to give me grace and mercy for those of whom I've hurt. Don't let hype cause you to be disillusioned. Don't let hypocrisy and the behavior of others cause you to lose your way. Don't let the hurt you're feeling that you've experienced. And I know it's complicated and I know it's painful. Church ought to be a place that's safe, right? Church ought to be a place where you never have to even put your guards down. But it happens. As a pastor for 30 years, my hurt, I could feel that I had developed a wound. Weariness and being wounded had tainted my ability to communicate effectively. In one sense, my material, the words I was saying, were the best sermons I was ever preaching. But because I was weary and because I was hurt and wounded, as a pastor, and I pray that you'll always pray for your pastor because it's almost a human impossibility to be a successful pastor when it comes to how people expect from you and what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to lead people and you're supposed to guide people and you're supposed to shepherd people. And at the same time, you're a human being. You hurt, you have problems, you have difficulties. And a pastor has to separate the vessel from the treasure. And you have to know, I'm anointed, I'm called. I'm called to love and help everybody. I'm the leader. We can get us out of this mess. I know what I'm doing. God's called me. But then on a personal level, you got to keep examining yourself because that hurt can keep accumulating until your heart is wounded. And people were hinting to me, my wife and others were saying, you know, you're coming across in a tone. Or perhaps I felt frustrated because I was saying something, but nobody was responding or respecting. I would say, I want you to do this, but they were not really hearing it, is because my hurt was talking. And so I had lost my way. Today, I'm asking you to get over maybe the hype, the hypocrisy, the hurt, and get found. When I was growing up, we used to play hide and seek. And that was always fun. And it was great to go hide. And when you found a really great place to hide, it was pretty cool to watch people like walk past where you were hiding and you could hear them. And then all of a sudden you could realize, oh, most of everyone's been found. And then you realize, I'm the only one that hasn't been found. Basically, I won the game. This is so cool. But there were times where I was like, man, they'll never find me. And you know what? They didn't. They got bored and moved on. And I'm like, hey, wait just a second. This is called hide and seek, not hide and quit. And so I was like, hey, and I had to come out and say, hey guys, I was over here. It's like, okay, well, you know, in life, we get lost, we get hurt, we face hypocrisy and we face the hypocrites. We go through seasons where we feel like, you know what? I need to hide. I need to isolate. I need to protect myself. And we hide too well. And then no one calls and nobody misses us. And it seems as if you fell off the planet and nobody cares. And then that happens. You are truly bewildered. You are lost. I heard of a story of a doctor who had dealt with death and cancer and discovered that he had cancer and it was terminal and that he only had a few months to live. And he didn't tell anybody. And sure enough, he died. And at the funeral and afterwards, people were talking about what a hero he was. Wow, what a guy. He went through this on his own, didn't tell anybody. But as the days passed, the family and friends became bitter. They became angry because they recognized that they wanted to be a part of this journey. And they were cheated from that. And he wasn't a hero to them. They felt as if he hid too well. Today, get found. Get found. Come out of your hiding. Find your focus. Philippians tells us, brethren, the one thing you need to be focused on is one thing I do. I forget those things which are behind me, and I press towards the mark of the high calling that is ahead. I don't care if you've been disappointed with the hype and the hypocrisy and the hurt. Right now, pray. I want to get found. I'm going to get my focus back. Find your fervency again. Revelation 2:4 says, Christ is speaking to the church, and he says, I have this against you. You have left your first love. I'm speaking to you today because you have left your first love. And maybe that happened gradually. It's like when you're out in an ocean and you see where your stuff is. You see where your family is. And yet somehow the waves cause you to drift. And the next thing you know, you're lost. You don't know where your mark is. And that can happen. You lose your focus. You lose your fervency. Get found. Find your faithfulness. Get back in the game. Galatians 6:9 says, don't grow weary in doing good. What does that mean? That means evidently, even when you're doing good, you can get weary. You were doing good. You were doing fantastic. Now don't get weary in it. For in due season, you're going to reap if you don't lose heart. Don't lose heart today. As I pray for you in these final moments, I'm praying that the Holy Spirit would just come right into that room where you are right now. And the first thing you need to do is, they say when a person's lost, the first thing they do is deny it. They're in denial. And then it goes from denial to anger. And then it goes from anger to depression. And then finally, if they ever get found, they come to a place of acceptance. They ask for help. And they recognize they're lost. Today, again, I'm not speaking to your eternal salvation. I'm speaking to the purpose and the destiny that God has for your life. And you have faced things that maybe you didn't choose. Or maybe you did choose some things that weren't right. And for some reason you have hid. And on the outside you smile. And on the outside you seem to be okay. But inside, you are totally bewildered. I speak now the grace of God. Can you hear the Father say to you, come home, come home. The ring, the fatted calf, and the robe is ready for you. Can you hear the sound of God saying, you're my child. I've not given up on you. Don't give up on me. Can you feel the love that God is reaching out to you right now? Say yes to it. Father, as the people I speak to today, I believe you're pouring oil of healing over their hurt. I believe that you are breaking the hardness that comes from being judgmental and allowing the hypocrisy of others to cause you to lose your way. I'm praying now that all the hurt and the hurt that you've held on to is dissipating even as I speak. It's as if the sting of what was done to you, innocently or deliberately, has been removed. Sure, it happened. But God is freeing you now And so in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, get found. We love you. We need you. You're about to step into the greatest days of your life. Thank you so much. Know you're loved. We'll see you next time.